and our students from Rutgers North undergraduate population. It's awesome to see you. So excited today because we're at a moment where we really need to think about what it means to go global, what it means to be a global citizen. A lot of you guys are studying global affairs. Some of you are studying international relations or international business, but you've never been out of the country, right? So what does it mean to actually kind of put theory into practice, what we're learning in the classroom, and take it into the field? Really excited to introduce Emily McGlone, the director of Peace Boat USA. Emily has been working with Peace Boat since 2004 and is currently the United Nations liaison and director of the New York-based office of Peace Boat USA, a nonprofit organization working to promote peace, sustainable development, and respect for the environment through educational programs organized on board the Peace Boat, a chartered passenger ship that travels the world on peace voyages. Peace Boat holds special consultative status with the Social and Economic Council of the United Nations and works in partnership with the UN, Nobel Peace laureates, and community leaders from around the world to create opportunities for international cooperation focused on conflict resolution, environmental sustainability, indigenous issues, cultural awareness, and peace education. Emily works to foster youth education and develop specific programs for families, students, and young diplomats to learn about important global issues on board the Peace Boat. Founded in 1983 and nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize in 2008, Peace Boat has sailed on over 92 global voyages, carrying more than 50,000 people to more than 100 countries. Peace Boat has recently launched a new initiative to build an eco-ship to sail in 2020, which will showcase green technology and design while inspiring positive change to radically reduce our carbon footprint. I want you to know that many of our Rutgers students have actually interned at Peace Boat. And so if you're interested after the talk, you can talk to Emily or myself, and we'll explore more. Emily, thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you. Well, thank you for all of you for coming today to the presentation. This is probably the fourth or fifth time that I've come to Rutgers University to speak to students, but it's my first time in this venue, so thank you so much for being here today. I'm really excited to work with university students, one, because as Natalie mentioned, many of the Rutgers students have interned at our office, and it's always been a delight to work with each and every one of you, and two, because we have some very exciting programs which I would like to invite you to join us on the ship this summer. So I'm hoping that after we have a little bit of a presentation, I'm going to show some photos of the Peace Boat, we can have a bit of a Q&A and kind of an open discussion. So please save some questions that you have in your mind for the end, but along the way, if you do see something that interests you, feel free to raise your hand and we'll take questions and comments as we go. Again, so my name is Emily McGlone, and I'm just going to stand here so I can do the slides, if that's okay. Can everybody see the screen okay? Is that right? As Natalie mentioned, I'm working as the director of the international organization Peace Boat, and this is our cruise ship. Our ship was organized as an international organization in 1983, and we didn't have this ship at the time. Peace Boat was founded by four university students in Japan, who started by using a small ferry to travel within Asia, going from Japan to Korea and China, and later the Philippines and Singapore, traveling to build friendships across borders and to promote intercultural understanding amongst Asian countries. And in 1990, we did our first global voyage with Peace Boat. And now the Peace Boat visits more than 20 or 22 countries in each global voyage. You can see here on the screen, our main office is located in Tokyo, Japan, and that's where Peace Boat was founded in 1983. And on each global voyage, we sometimes will take the route south here through Southeast Asia, and then later going up into the Middle East, like through the Mediterranean seas, and sometimes we go up into the Baltic region and north, and then over Central America. Other times we take the southern route, where we go through Southeast Asia, come down to South Africa, visiting Kenya, maybe Cape Town, and then over to Namibia, crossing the ocean to Brazil, Argentina, and Chile. And other times we have a more northern voyage, maybe going up into Alaska and to Canada. So we alternate between these three global voyages every year, visiting more than 100 countries during our global voyages for peace. On the ship, we're very proud to host a multi-generational kind of community on board, made up of young children ages 2 to 7 years old in the Montessori education program. Has anybody been here at Montessori? Remember? A couple of people, yeah? Well, Montessori is a great way to have young children mixed between various ages in the same classroom, where the older children teach the younger children, and it's all about experiential learning, so it fits very well on the Peace Boat. We also have a lot of university students, and for those of you in the back, feel free to come on in and grab a chair alongside.
We have some chairs up here, guys.
Mm-hmm. You guys can feel free to pull these out. We'd like everybody to come have a seat and be able to see the screen. So we have a lot of university students like yourselves, maybe some graduate students as well, or people taking a gap year and just taking a break from university, or those coming during summer break. And we also have a lot of retirees. The Peace Boat believes in lifelong learning. So this multi-generational experience on the Peace Boat is very unique to our organization. You normally wouldn't find an 85-year-old traveling together with a 25-year-old going to see the pyramids of Egypt. But on the Peace Boat, that shared experience really facilitates conversation and friendships amongst all ages. As you can also see from the photo, the majority of our participants are from Asia. As I mentioned, Peace Boat was founded in 1983 in Japan, which means most of our staff members are Japanese and our main office is in Tokyo. I myself am originally from California. I went to UNC Chapel Hill in North Carolina, graduated with an international relations major, and then moved to Japan. And 10 years later, I found myself having traveled the world, working for Peace Boat in Tokyo, and living in Japan for a decade. At that time, I decided to come back to the United States, and now I work in New York City, and have all the experience of living and working in Japan and Asia, and now bringing that to the United States, and reaching out to students like you to see how we can foster more collaboration and more international exchange with students from the United States and the Asian population that we find on board. When we depart from Japan, it's a huge departure ceremony, a big farewell to everybody waiting in the port. So all the people on the boat, this photo is taken from the ship, everybody waving goodbye, and all the friends and family along the coast waving off their partners and friends to go on a three-month journey. Peace Boat starts in Japan, goes 3 months around the world, and ends up in Japan again. So when people say farewell, they say we'll see you again soon. And these streamers that we have is a long-time maritime tradition where the sailors used to throw out the rope to their friends and family and hold onto the rope as the ship is taking off until the rope breaks. And here we have eco-friendly biodegradable streamers, but we hold those out and throw those to our family members. It's kind of a tradition in every port, and saying goodbye to the friends and family that we meet. Again, our Global Voyages for Peace, as I mentioned, visit 3 different regions of the world. And so 10 to 20 different countries are added to our itinerary every year. The countries that we visit are decided about, I'd say, almost a year to 2 years ahead of time. So if you look at our website, you will see all the itineraries up until 2018 already online. And we decide these based on the socio-political situation of the country, geographic location, as I mentioned, if we're going north. For example, right now, it's cold in the winter, and you wouldn't want to be traveling through Europe when it's so cold. So our current voyage is actually in South America right now, where it's a bit warmer and you can really enjoy sailing on the open seas. And I'm traveling to Chile on Friday. I was telling Natalie that I'm glad I got to come speak to you today because I'll be gone the rest of the month. I'll be flying down to South America. Has anybody here ever been to South America? Only a couple. Okay, we're gonna have to get you guys on the Peace Boat. That's one of my most favorite places of the world, is Chile, Brazil, Argentina, this whole southern region has really been an inspiring place in my life and changed me for the better. So we'll be flying down to Valparaiso, Chile. We'll be going down to visit Patagonia, hiking in the glaciers and the mountains. I'm a big nature lover, so I like to be outdoors. And then taking the Peace Boat from Valparaiso up to Peru, and on board the ship we'll have about 4 or 5 days organizing educational programs about the Sustainable Development Goals and focusing on climate action and environmental issues. So on board the ship, we have guest speakers who come and give lectures and workshops every day. So the ship is basically an educational space that we use to provide content about the places that we're visiting. For example, in this photo, on the left-hand side, we have Heather Bowser, who is a survivor, as a second-generation survivor, from the Agent Orange that was used in the Vietnam War. Her father fought in the Vietnam War, was affected by Agent Orange, and then she was actually born later with deformities due to that Agent Orange that was spread. And then next to her, we have a model who was represented as kind of a young Miss America princess, also affected by Agent Orange. And the person sitting next to her is Kenneth, and Kenneth was actually fighting in the war at the time. So these are kind of 3 generations of people who had experienced Agent Orange, and as we were traveling from Japan to Vietnam, speaking about the Vietnam War, we had them come on board and give their testimonies. We think that it's really important. When we learn from guest speakers, we love to have people give their personal stories because it makes it so much more real than just reading a textbook or listening to a conversation. If someone can actually give you the real experience, it's something that you remember forever. Other guest speakers, like here we have Peter from San Francisco. He talks about bioregionalism and learning about your own bioregion. Where do you live? He would have us, for example, draw maps of your city. How many people think you could draw a map of your campus? Anybody? A couple? Yeah, when you think about the space where you live, right, your walk from home to school or to the train, where do the rivers flow, where do the mountains come in, where does the fresh air and the wind come from? This is what you learn about bioregionalism. So not just taking for granted the cities we live in, but actually thinking about the nature and the environment that we need to protect in our cities. And we often have guest speakers also like Lalita Ramdas here from India. She was the head of Greenpeace International and also works for peace and conflict resolution in India. And she's a very inspiring speaker who will do workshops and use theater and education to talk about these issues while she's traveling with us on the peace boat. Other times we use art and music, for example, inviting young people to give their own advice to the world through maybe spoken word or poetry or rap or other kinds of music. We like to use the arts definitely as a tool to talk about social issues on board. And other kinds of creativity, for example, this is a guest speaker named Dragon, and he's a famous painter from Tokyo who recently just moved to New York. So if you like mural paintings and street art, look him up. Dragon76 is his name. And he just painted a mural for us in Brooklyn at one of our events recently. But all of his paintings have a social theme. This was a painting that he did on the peace boat during his workshops. You can see on the bottom left it says Liberty. He also went to Cuba with us and painted murals in the streets and has worked on so many programs with Peace Boat, using art as a tool for raising political awareness. In New York City, we also partner with nonprofit organizations like Global Kids. Global Kids is an amazing partner that we have been working with for many years to bring students on board the Peace Boat, mostly high school age students. Global Kids is a nonprofit that started to work with minority children from all around the New York City area, to give them after-school programs to help keep them in school and keep them motivated and give them opportunities to attend events at the United Nations or to do high-level programs that most students don't have the opportunity to experience in their high school days. And every year, Global Kids works with us to bring a group of students on the Peace Boat and have them be part of our global voyage. Again, we like to use music and art, so of course we're going to celebrate Noche Latina on the boat. This was when we were on our way to Cuba. We had guest speakers who came on board and did drumming workshops, salsa workshops. Of course, if you go to Cuba and Latin America, you have to learn how to dance salsa or at least get the rhythm. So on the boat, we have lots of opportunities to learn about local cultures through dance and music. We have professionals that come on board and teach, and then we also have staff like myself who will organize additional practice workshops. And we invite all the participants on board, like yourselves as well, if you're interested in a specific kind of dance, music, art, or any kind of talent that you might have, whether it be photography or drawing, that you can also organize your own events on board. And this is what a typical lecture hall would look like on the Peace Boat. Our largest lecture hall holds about 500 people, and that's the Broadway showroom. And then we have smaller spaces that could be for 150 or 200 people. And then we can also have small groups and workshop spaces. So you're not always in a big conference hall, but at the same time, when there are big presentations or talent shows or important guest speakers, everybody will get a chance to hear from them. And this is how I actually got involved in Peace Boat. This is a photo of our global English and Espanol training program known as GET. And the GET program invites young people of all ages and backgrounds to come on board and teach English as a second language, Spanish as a second language, and also Japanese. So we have primarily Japanese participants traveling with us on board, and many of them want to use English to communicate with other people in the countries that we visit. And then a lot of people are interested in learning Spanish. When we go to Latin America or even in Europe, you find that Spanish can be very useful. So we have these intensive classes, about 5 or 6 people per class, and the volunteers who teach English and Spanish can travel for free around the world. So you can also sign up as a volunteer like I did. I was a Spanish teacher. This is back in 2004 when I first found out about Peace Boat. All the applications are on our website, so you can download all the info and see what you need. We kind of request that people have about 2 years of experience teaching, And you can get that through volunteering after school here at the university. Teaching English as a second language is quite common, especially in these areas where there's a lot of multicultural backgrounds. And so I think finding a way to tutor someone on the side or be an assistant in one of your classes that's a language class with professors here at the university is a great way to get some experience. And then you can travel with the Peace Boat and teach on board. And all of the teachers, as I mentioned, come from different countries. I have teachers from Brazil, from Australia, from Turkey. You don't even have to be a native English speaker to teach, because we believe in global English. So using language as a tool for communication, not just teaching it, you know, with the grammar, but also teaching communication, how to ask questions when you're traveling and get by when you're in a country and you don't know your way around. These are very useful tips that we teach in our classes as well. And we have a lot of fun. All of the English teachers is about 10 to 15 teachers per voyage. You get to go visit, for example, the pyramids in Egypt. You get to travel to all the amazing countries that we go to and work together to do lesson planning. So you're not teaching on your own. You have a team of teachers that you work with. It's kind of like your classmates, and you can exchange lesson plans and brainstorm ideas. And even hold down the bottom left is a Get Olympics. So using language in Olympic setting and kind of having like fun contests through language too. So we do make everything that we do on the Peace Boat a lot of fun. And so just a few more photos of the inside of the ship, some of the conference rooms and the reception that we have. The bedrooms as well, you can see that our cabins, we have a pool, and all the cabins and the outdoor spaces are very accommodating. It's a regular cruise ship. The only difference is that we don't have a casino on the ship. So has anybody here been on a cruise ship? A few? Did you have a casino? Mm-hmm. Did you have an open bar? Did you enjoy it? I think there's a different kind of cruising industry that's out there these days that definitely is a little bit over the top. It's a little bit, I would say, you know, kind of focusing on some of the consumer culture even. And you want to go on a cruise ship and you want to enjoy yourself. But I think that on Peace Boat, you find that things are a little bit more of a nonprofit status. So, you know, we do have buffets for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And we do have bars, but it's not like open bar all the time. It's more focused on the education. And we took out the casinos and we put in workshop spaces and maybe like a dance hall. So everything that we do on the Peace Boat is focused more on the education and not so much just on the extravagance of traveling on the boat. This photo is a little bit dark on the screen, but this is just overlooking the ocean at sunset. And we tend to really use our outdoor spaces as well for conferences and lectures. This is one of my favorite guest speakers on the very right-hand side, Gabriel Titiarahi. He is an indigenous leader from Tahiti, and he is speaking with one of our staff members, I, on his left. And when we were traveling on the Peace Boat and we heard Gabby's story for the first time, it was really inspiring because he told us about when he was a young boy in the Tahitian Islands and France was doing nuclear testing in their ocean. And he's sitting on the hill and he sees, you know, bombs being dropped into the ocean and the mushroom cloud. You all know what the mushroom cloud of the nuclear bombs looks like, right? Imagine seeing that in the ocean in front of you as a young boy, but not understanding at all, what is this mushroom cloud, where did this come from? It kind of looked like fireworks to him in the ocean. But later they found that there were so many cases of cancer in Tahiti, so many different issues of people being affected by the nuclear radiation, not only on land, but also the water, the ocean life, everything that was affected by the nuclear testing started to come around, and Gabby decided to go study more about nuclear issues. So he went to France and studied about nuclear issues there on his own and came back as a nuclear activist to Tahiti, working with indigenous populations to help them educate communities about what had been taking place on their land and also how to do organic farming as an indigenous community and how to really take advantage of the nature that was still left and protected to be able to use it for the benefit of their communities. So this is Gabby from Tahiti, and he loves to do his lectures outside barefoot on the back deck. Mm-hmm. So we like to use that space for lectures too. And we also use the outdoor space for fun presentations like this group that came from Kenya doing drumming workshops. They would bring a group of djembes on the boat, and we would all get to learn how to play the djembe and practice traditional African dances together. And at the end, we would do a big festival outside. I'm gonna just make this photo a bit bigger. But we would make it, you know, outside. This is on the deck at nighttime having our party. So the deck can be used for all kinds of cultural activities. And speaking of culture, this was a very important cultural exchange program that we organized. This is our international students program focused on conflict resolution. And on the right, we have Rami from Palestine, and on the left, we have Karen from Israel. And part of our conflict resolution programs for international students is to bring students from conflict regions onto the boat together, because the boat provides a mutual, neutral space where they can have real conversations, and that really fosters international exchange and friendship across borders. And so normally, you don't have the chance, when you're a Palestinian young man, you don't have a chance to meet with people from Israel on a friendly basis. And Rami had never met anybody from Israel, and never, or at least, you know, spoken to them in this kind of context. And so when he came on the boat, we remember very fondly Rami being very excited to travel on the peace boat. But after we introduced him to Karen, and you know, we said, okay, Rami, you know, introduce yourself, like, shake hands, and they met for the first time. It took Rami about 3 more days to get over his anger of having shaken hands with somebody from Israel who he felt was really threatening his family and his community. But through workshops and kind of non-traditional means, which is on the peace boat, having fun together, eating meals together, learning, talking together, overlooking the ocean at sunsets, and having great conversations, they were able to become friends, and they were able to really build a friendship that lasted. And they started singing a song together, Salam Shalom, in both Arabic and Hebrew. And then not only did they become friends on the peace boat, but they stayed friends for years and years. And through their friendship, then started a new project to bring more students from Palestine and Israel onto the boat. And most recently, we had a program with 80 students. So from these 2 students, then grew to 80 students, 40 from Palestine and 40 from Israel. And they continue organizing these programs today. So this is one of our really big success stories and how we can bridge the gap amongst cultures and even help countries who might be opposed at war build friendship through this neutral space on the peace boat. And the founder of Peace Boat, his name is Yoshioka Tatsuya, he's on the right-hand side here, is the big inspiration for most of the programs and a lot of the decisions that we make today. He continues to work as the executive director and co-founder of Peace Boat. And this is a Nobel Peace World Summit that was held with Nobel laureates from around the world in Hiroshima, Japan. As you all know, Hiroshima and Nagasaki were 2 of the only cities to ever have been affected by nuclear bombs. And so that was a very important place for them to hold this Nobel Peace World Summit. And at the same time, we thought it was appropriate to launch our new program there to create a nuclear weapon-free zone in the Middle East. And this is a big project that Peace Boat continues to work on and believe in, even though these days things are getting more and more challenging in the Middle East as the conflict continues. But by having the Nobel Peace Laureates on board with the program, we try to work with high-level delegates to get the word out and, you know, gain support for a nonprofit and NGO like us, who, although we're working with the United Nations and with Nobel Peace delegates in many countries, it's always important to have as many people engaged and supporting our projects as possible. And then with our partnership with the United Nations, we actually started to use our ship as a literal kind of flagship for the Millennium Development Goals and now for the SDGs. So we painted this logo from the United Nations Millennium Campaign on the side of our ship. You can see here, this is still the founder of Peace Boat, jumping up with a bunch of students who are working on the Millennium Campaign. And the MDGs, you know, were 8 goals that were set to end poverty by 2015, focus on education and equality. And we know that that was really difficult. And now it's 2017, and we haven't ended poverty yet. So who knows what the United Nations started recently. Not the MDGs, but it's the... I'm positive some of you know this. There's 17 goals focused on... Okay, who has the summer program in front of them? Look at the first couple words at the very top of the page.
SDGs.
SDGs, that's right, sustainable development. So we went from Peace Boat with the Millennium Campaign to work on the SDGs, which is the Sustainable Development Goals. And there's 17 goals now which have replaced the MDGs to work towards sustainability. And Peace Boat often works with the United Nations to support these campaigns because, for exactly this reason, not everybody hears about the campaigns that the United Nations launches, especially young people. And so it's our goal as an international organization in consultative status with the United Nations to bring those campaigns to young people like yourselves, because all of you can be ambassadors for these UN campaigns if you're interested in these issues. Specifically with the United Nations now, there are 17 goals that cover all of the different topics that Peace Boat works on, so you'll often find that we have a lot of overlap in our program ideas. This is us performing drums at the United Nations headquarters, And in New York City, we're always participating in United Nations conferences. But not only in New York City, we're also traveling abroad to participate in UN conferences. So this is the Rio Plus 20 conference that was held in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. And I attended this conference with three or four staff members and also four members from Fukushima, Japan. Fukushima sound familiar to most of you, right? The nuclear accident that happened in 2011. This was a huge issue in Japan and all around the world and still continues to be damaging to the environmental and kind of social fabric of Japan. But we brought four residents to give their testimonies to speak about why nuclear energy is not sustainable. Because when we have the Rio Plus 20 Conference on Sustainable Development by the United Nations, they're talking about all kinds of energy sources. And it's really important to learn from local people on how it's been affecting their communities. We had women and kind of young students who were talking about how their communities had to be evacuated after Fukushima, and they're continuing today to experience the radiation that continues to leak from the plant. So that's one issue that we continue to work on with Peace Boat. And we don't only use the ship as a way to transport people and ideas, but also goods and services and sometimes donations as needed by our local partners. So this is a group of volunteers working to load on wheelchairs onto the ship. We had a huge donation of wheelchairs from hospitals in Japan that we brought on the ship through the ocean, the Mediterranean, over to Jordan, where we unloaded in Jordan and took them to a hospital in Iraq. This is many years ago after the Iraq war, to deliver them to hospitals who needed wheelchairs. We also have collected school desks. These were for a desk in El Salvador, some of our partners there who needed some more school supplies. We also collect instruments. So for those of you who like to play instruments, if you have an old violin or an old keyboard or recorder or anything lying around that you don't need, guitars, we take those instruments and we provide them to our partners. For example, in Venezuela, we work with the Youth Orchestra. This is the Simon Bolivar Youth Orchestra, one of the most amazing orchestras in all of Latin America and the world, I believe. I used to work in Venezuela for about 5 years, off and on, a month at a time, organizing programs. And this is a really inspirational program to me because there is so much violence, if you've seen the news in Venezuela, or maybe some of you are from Venezuela and have kept up with it. But it's a really difficult time right now, especially in a city like Caracas, which has a really high rate of crime and violence and homicides every single day. And so young people there are often left without opportunities to continue their studies after school. And so what we've done is provide them with musical instruments to keep them involved in practicing instruments after school with the music program. And then they get to perform on stage, which, you know, empowers the youth, helps them feel like they're important, and actually being able to learn an instrument like that can really change the life of anyone. So this is part of our music program, and it's part of our also donations program, which is the United People's Alliance, to bring donations on board the ship. Okay, how about sports? Does anybody here play soccer? No one? Wow, really? Well, I used to play soccer in high school, and that was one of my favorite sports. And we have a soccer program called the Peace Ball. So on the Peace Boat, we actually have a soccer field, which is enclosed by a net so the ball doesn't go into the ocean. And we also collect soccer balls as donations that we then deliver to the communities that we work with as part of our Peace Ball program. And not just donating the balls, but actually having our team that practices on the Peace Boat, on our deck, then go play with those teams in different countries. And that's a great way to do cultural exchange through sports. You can overcome language barriers and different cultures and create friendships through soccer as well. And right now, as I'm heading to Chile, this is kind of one of the most important photos that's coming up in my mind, is the disaster relief work that we do. So I was in Japan, working there for 10 years, and during that time, traveling to Chile to organize different programs in the Peace Boat Visit South America. And there was a huge earthquake in 2010, 8.9 earthquake in Chile, just as Peace Boat was around the coast of South America. So we had the chance to actually use the ship as a way to bring humanitarian relief to those who were affected by the earthquake and tsunami in Chile. We collected blankets, as you can see on the right-hand side, donations, water, all kinds of material goods from the ship and then offloaded to help our partners in Chile. Right after that is when the earthquake in Japan happened as well, and since then, We've started the Peace Boat Disaster Relief Volunteer Center. So if you are interested in disaster relief in any way, we have a whole new center set up in Japan where you can volunteer and get involved. And as I'm heading to Chile right now, there's huge forest fires which have been raging through more than, you know, 5 or 6 different areas in Chile, about 95 forest fires in total, I believe. So we're looking at ways to raise funds and to support the families and communities that have been affected there. And then we had another program called the Hibakusha Project. So you can see Peace Boat really does a little bit of everything. It's just so many different programs, everything focused on peace, disarmament, sustainable development, gender equality. We really do everything under the umbrella of peace. And as I mentioned, Japan is one of the only countries in Hiroshima and Nagasaki to suffer a nuclear attack. And so we decided to bring survivors from Hiroshima and Nagasaki to come onto the Peace Boat and give their testimonies firsthand as we travel. Our very first global voyage for a nuclear-free world, as we called it, was started in 2008 with 108 survivors from Hiroshima and Nagasaki on the Peace Boat coming to speak around the world. So we invited them in each country to come off the boat with us and give their testimonies in different settings and to different kinds of people, whether it be United Nations delegates or organizing something like this in a plaza. So I think this is a plaza in Spain where we put on the top of the banner, "No Mas Hiroshima, No Mas Guernica." And we didn't want to just go into the plaza and to kind of put out the banner and have them speak, but we used music and art as a tool to gather people's attention. So when we had our dance team dancing for peace in the plaza, people kind of gathered around, and after we had a good crowd, we would then ask the survivors to give their testimony so that more people can hear and engage with the program. And we always continue to use dance and theater on the Peace Boat as well, getting students involved and asking students what kind of music, what kind of activities they want to see on the boat. As I mentioned, we try to make everything fun on the Peace Boat and everything engaging. So it's not just the Peace Boat staff members and the guest speakers giving the lectures, but everybody gets to get involved. And all of our international students come up with ideas. Apart from the dance and music, we also have a lot of sports and culture. Whether it be eco fashion shows, like one we just organized in New York recently, or, you know, organizing Olympics events on board, or having some kind of sports day, or Earth Day on the ship if we're traveling in April and people are interested in environmental issues. We really try to use creative programming to keep everyone engaged during the 3-month voyage. So it might seem like a long time on the ship, 3 months, but every day there's more than 60 events taking place, and so you're never bored and never a lack of things to do. And then we come to the ports of call. So all of those activities and programs are really taking place on the Peace Boat and programming ideas that we have from our main office. But then we have the study programs in the ports that we visit as well. So in each country, we have about 5 or 6 programs that you can choose from various topics. So for example, on the left-hand side here, we have a group working on a demining campaign in Cambodia, where they would go in with local groups and work to demine the land, taking out the landmines and clearing the land so that later we can build schools in that area and use it as an educational space. On the top right hand, we have people learning about organic farming. This could be in Tahiti with indigenous communities I mentioned with Gabby. On the bottom right hand is one of the programs that really was most impactful, I would say, to me when I was on the Peace Boat. It's a homestay program with a Palestinian refugee camp in Jordan. And a lot of people think about Palestinian refugee camps as a refugee camp that has tents and people giving out water, as a lot of refugee camps might be in Europe these days or in all over Northern Africa. But the Palestinian refugee camps have been there since the 1960s. And they have communities built and schools and families, and so we have a chance to go stay at their homes and to visit with them and learn firsthand about what kind of experiences they've had leaving their homeland and coming as a refugee to Jordan. And then on the bottom left, we have a cultural exchange with the youth in Vietnam, which they always bring hundreds of youth to welcome the Peace Boat in Vietnam when we visit, and they take us around the city to have a cultural exchange with youth. So there's all kinds of programs you can join on Peace Boat, and they're all optional. So in each program, you might be working with our guest speakers like Gabrielle, going to his community, working with indigenous communities, or learning firsthand about some of the issues. You might jump on a bus with your friends and take a trip an hour through the city and learn about the historical sites in the country you're visiting. Or you might take another boat off the Peace Boat and go down the river and work with local communities and learn about their kind of sustainable development. Every place we go on the Peace Boat, we try to have a positive impact on the communities that we visit. And this is the Embera Indigenous Community in Panama, and we'll be visiting there this summer. If you join our summer program, which I'll introduce you at the very end, we'll be visiting three countries in a short 10-day program, visiting Panama, Nicaragua, and El Salvador. And this is one of the communities that we'll get to visit. Peace Boat tries to always visit our partner organizations at least once a year. So although we're going the Northern Hemisphere, Central, and then Southern Hemisphere, during one of those trips, we try to visit our partners to keep our relationships going and to always find out what it is that they need in their community. What are the issues that they're struggling with, or what kind of things do they want to teach us? Peace Boat doesn't go to communities to teach, we go to learn. And then our teaching really takes place on the Peace Boat, where we use the ship as an educational space with our guest speakers, providing workshops and lectures every day. And each of the places that we visit, you know, for example, this is in Venezuela, again, a place where there's so much violence and crime, but they also have free healthcare. So comparing, you know, what is the United States right now? That's one of our biggest challenges with healthcare and all the reforms taking place. So what is it like to learn from a country that might have free healthcare, and how does that work? But then what are those challenges that they face? All of the exchanges that we do help us to learn about the local realities and encourages also our local friends and partners to get involved with the Peace Boat, whether it be through art, music, wellness. We have a lot of yoga and education. All of these different programs are really important to us, and we try to be as diverse as possible. Right now, I'm leading the project in Chile and Peru. As I was mentioning, I'll be traveling to South America next week. And our biggest campaign there is to protect the natural resources in Patagonia. And especially now with climate change being such a big issue on the table and looking at the warming of the glaciers and the melting of all of our natural resources into the ocean, this is a place that we really need to work to protect. And so we have often a youth program where we bring together youth from Chile, from Argentina, and from other areas of South America to come on the Peace Boat and look at Patagonia and how we can protect it as a World Heritage Site recognized by UNESCO, so that other multinational corporations aren't coming in and taking advantage of these natural resources, which we need to protect, not just for this region, but for all of us and for the future of our planet. This is what it looks like when you're sailing through the beautiful fjords of Patagonia on the Peace Boat. We even have a program that takes our participants from Patagonia down to Antarctica. So we have another boat that we charter another ship that goes down, and people are able to visit Antarctica when they go through the southern fjords. And that's really exciting because I'm heading there this week. So I'm looking forward to kind of working on these campaigns and sharing my stories with you when I get back. And last but not least, I would just like to encourage you to come on the Peace Boat. You can visit our website, peaceboat-us.org. I also brought some additional pamphlets for those of you who are interested. Maybe what I can do here is I can leave them at the front, and then at the end, after we do some Q&A, for those of you who want to see, we have some information about our EcoShip project. A lot of people ask, well, you're promoting peace and sustainability, but is it sustainable to travel on a cruise ship, and how does that work? And although our cruise ship is not a traditional kind of voyage where you might have, you know, as I mentioned, all the amenities of other cruise ships, we try to keep it more sustainable by using all of our paper on board and recycling and trying to be low cost and just trying to be mindful every day on how much energy we use, making sure we turn off the lights, really treating the Peace Boat as kind of our home and as our earth and actually taking care of it as we travel. This brochure shows you all of the different voyages for each 3 months to show you which countries we're visiting and when. So if you want to come browse and see the exciting places that we're going, you can have a look. And this brochure is about our international education programs with Peace Boat and the Global University. So we call Global University the Special Educational Program Board, not just for university students, it's for all ages and all backgrounds. You don't have to be in university to take it, but we call it Global University because you have a lot of learning that goes on during this program. We combine the learning, exposure, and practice in our Peace Boat programs, and we're also hoping to now start partnering with Rutgers University in the near future to offer Peace Boat-led programs for students and Rutgers-led programs on the Peace Boat using our ship as a venue. So this is a great kind of brochure to talk a little bit more about some of those programs. I also like to be in direct contact with all of you, so if you're interested, I also have my name card up here, and you can come pick one up at the end if you want to have a little conversation and just get to know more about Peace Boat. Natalie mentioned our internship program, so we have a rolling basis of internships going on all year round. All of our interns get a pass to the United Nations, like this one, where you can attend conferences and workshops on your own and enter the United Nations and be part of those conversations. And that's really important because we feel a lot of students, especially who are interested in human rights, gender equality, sustainable development, or indigenous issues, these are important world issues, but getting into the United Nations can be quite a challenge, and sometimes students even get discouraged for applying even for an internship at the UN. Some of you here might have some experience at the UN, you can share too, and it's just a great way for students to get their foot in the door in international relations and these kind of positions. So we really encourage you to apply for the internship. And this summer, we're hosting a combination of those people who would like to join an internship and then travel with us on the Peace Boat, and those who would just like to travel for this 10 to 12 day experience on the boat. So does everybody have a summer program in front of you? Hopefully everybody got a copy. So I'm just gonna kind of go through a little bit what this summer program is like. We know that Peace Boat voyages, being 3 months long, might not quite fit into your whole summer schedule because it's a long time to take off from work and from school. So we've created these short programs specifically for those who are studying or those who are interested in learning more on the Peace Boat. We'll be doing our first orientation session in New York City on June 20th, and that will be at the Peace Boat office, or you can join by Skype. And this will be just an orientation about the program itself. We're going to be focusing on peace education and the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which are those 17 goals focused on various issues to create sustainable development worldwide. And in this program, we will travel from New York City down to Panama City, where we'll visit the United Nations Development Program office and have a briefing about what are the UN Sustainable Development Goals and how they're being implemented in the region. We'll then be visiting a group called RET, which is Resilience Education and Training Program for Refugee Youth. As refugee topics are so important right now, we thought it was a great opportunity to work with youth who are refugees coming from the conflict region in Colombia up into Panama, and then taking refuge in Panama with this organization and learning from them. They're providing education and training for these youth, and they have a great program, so we're going to have an exchange with them. And then we'll also visit the indigenous communities of the photos that I showed you a little bit earlier, learning about what does it mean to create sustainable development programs with the indigenous communities that are already, you know, building their own livelihood in their own sustainable way. How to combine what they need, whether it be building sidewalks together or providing materials, or we had a request to help with a water tank to provide clean water, but in a way that fits in with their community and the way that they work together. So we'll be having a cultural exchange and study program with the Kuna or with the Mbera indigenous communities. And then the Peace Boat will be coming on its global voyage to Panama. So then we'll be jumping on the boat from Panama and sailing through the Panama Canal, which is pretty historic. They also last year just opened a new canal, which is very exciting. So the boat will travel through the canal. It's an all-day sailing process where you get to go through three different locks and stages of the canal. And then we'll be arriving one day later in Nicaragua. And in Nicaragua, we'll be focusing on climate action and looking at reforestation programs of the mangroves. I don't know if any of you have ever visited the mangroves, but they're, you know, the trees that are based in the water, along the coast, with the long roots that come out of the ocean. And those are very important parts of our ecosystem. And sometimes you don't get a chance to see those in our everyday city life, especially living here in New York City or in New Jersey. So we're going to be visiting the mangroves, and not only visiting, but also helping to reforest and be part of that program with local partners. After one day in Nicaragua, we get back on the boat and we end up in El Salvador. So that will be our disembarkation point. We'll get off the boat in El Salvador, and there we'll have a chance to also exchange with local partners and meet with the University of Don Bosco to have maybe a forum with students, and we'll spend 2 or 3 days there, and then come back to New York or New Jersey on July 3rd, just in time for July 4th celebrations. So that's kind of our summer program. It's a little bit less than 2 weeks. To go on the Peace Boat, there is a cost. That's always the question, usually the student's next question. So we have a nonprofit price, which is pretty competitive compared to most cruises. It's about $180, $150 a day, which includes food, accommodation, and travel, and all the educational experiences on the boat. It's cheaper than a hotel in New York, So people, you know, if they have a chance to rent out their apartment for 3 months and they want to come for the full voyage, that's great. If they want to come just for a short time, that's also possible. And as an intern in the office, you can gain a discount for coming on the boat. So internship hours can be added up, and then it can give you a 20, 30, or 40% discount, depending on how many hours you volunteer in the office. And then we're also working on group discounts for students from Rutgers. So if you guys can get 10 students together, we can make a group discount for students from here. So that's another opportunity. But this is our summer program. And every year, we'll be trying to make more programs like this on different issues. Again, the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals cover every topic. So whatever your interest is, I'm sure that you'll find something on board and something in the program. And right now, I'd just like to say thank you and open up a little bit for Q&A. But thank you so much for listening. Does anybody want to raise their hand if you have a question?
Yes, sure. I want to commend you. I think you do a very good job with what you do, like going to other places, because it's really a great thing when you go to another place and you meet diversity. But my question is this, with Mr. Trump's rhetoric and all the things he said during the campaigns, and say, like, for instance, you have to go to a Muslim country because he signed the executive order to ban Muslims. So what's your take on that? And someone comes to you and say, oh, America hates us. And how would you explain to them that you don't belong, you don't support what Mr. Trump is doing, mm-hmm. and you don't judge people by their ethnicity or by their religion? How do you, and also another question, the internship, is it paid or unpaid?
Good question. I'll start with the easy one, internship first. Yeah, so the internship is an unpaid position, but it's a very flexible position. Usually 2 days a week from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. Tuesdays and Thursdays are the normal hours. But we do have other possibilities for making it more flexible depending on your school schedule or if you have a part-time job. So we can definitely talk about that. And our internship application is also on our website. So you can just click on the Get Involved section. For talking about, yes, world religions and respect for other people and what kind of people we exchange with on our boat, we are always in contact, as you can imagine, with these 100 countries that we visit, with every kind of person. We have Arabic classes on the boat, and we can practice wearing the hijab when we visit Muslim countries. We also, when we go into, you know, the mosque, we often wear a headscarf because that's, you know, to follow the tradition of the local communities. So Peace Boat, as an international organization, we have no problem in standing up for what's right and for speaking our mind and promoting cultural diversity, international cooperation, and understanding amongst all cultures. This is a very, very challenging political time right now in the United States, and we understand that coming from the US, it can even give students a fear of travel, which is very unfortunate because it happened also when I went to South America in 2001, and then we had, you know, 9/11 happened, and people were protesting outside and against Americans, and so many things were happening at that time. But it's part of history, it's part of life, and we just have to always remember, I think, to stand up for what's right and to open our arms. Peace Boat is very welcoming to all groups to come on board. And as I mentioned, we have the Palestinian and Israeli youth. We've also had Iraqi youth, Iranian youth. We've had women from Morocco come on board for gender programs, so many different kinds of programs on board. So we try to create that neutral space and a welcoming environment and try to set the standard, you know, because we have to express ourselves as people who are educated and learning about these issues because we're interested in them, to help others understand that that's the way that we should be promoting a culture of peace and understanding. But it is a challenge, I agree. It kind of doubles our work. You know, we have to try just that much harder to make
it. I asked the question because of what you do, you're going to have people come to you. And personally, I grew up, you know, in a Muslim family. And people who are very close to me will tell you, I'm one of the most kind-hearted people. I don't really get the idea where you see a person and I was never taught to hate. That's what I'm trying to stress, that, you know, it's totally wrong. And if you know how it's very deep, you know, you explaining that to a person that because you're Muslim and they say, oh, you're from America, they say majority wins the votes, you know, you represent Mr. Trump, you know, it's, that's why I asked.
Yeah, no, thank you for the question. It's good. And we do, again, try to be the international organization, so.
Emily, can you talk about how PSPO helps sort of drive some policy outcomes or educate folks at the UN or, you know, just the people in power that you guys influence through this kind of soft diplomacy?
Sure. Yeah, so PSPO is an international NGO affiliated with the United Nations. That is one of our goals, is to bring the voice of the local communities that we visit to the UN, to the conferences, to all of the events taking place where there are delegates making important decisions. In Japan, we have about 150 staff members who are working on all of these issues across the globe, attending conferences and participating in all kinds of activities. In the United States, we have a very small team. So I work as the director of the entire office in New York, and we have our interns and part-time staff, which is why exactly interns get a very hands-on experience, because you're kind of right in there with us. One of the ways that we're influencing decision makers is by bringing in, as I mentioned earlier, for example, the Rio Plus 20 conference, bringing in residents from Fukushima to have their voices heard from the delegates who are attending those conferences. At that conference, for example, most people still are promoting nuclear energy as maybe a green technology and the new way to the future without carbon fossil fuels. But what about the radiation that comes from nuclear, how it's created, where it starts from, the reprocessing, the waste, where does that go? All of these things have to be taken into account. And the way to do that is to bring the real voice of civil society to those delegates so that they can hear those stories and make better decisions. The same goes for Hiroshima and Nagasaki, bringing survivors into the United Nations and having them speak about nuclear nonproliferation. And right now there has been a large movement for a nuclear ban treaty at the United Nations. And one of the big pushes for that has been actually survivors coming and giving their testimonies and delegates hearing those testimonies, which is something we feel very excited about because we know that we have changed the opinions of some delegates based on hearing the horrific stories of what happened after the nuclear attacks. For those survivors who are now getting almost too old to be able to share their stories, so this is a big push in the next few years to have their testimonies being shared in various languages with representatives from the UN. We also do get involved in some advocacy work, whether it be signing petitions. Right now with the Patagonia Project in South America, for example, Patagonia is divided in half into Argentina and half into Chile, but the half in Argentina has now been protected by some of the government officials, whereas the Chilean side has kind of not been protected yet because the government hasn't made a move due to economic interests of other corporations to protect the region. So through petitions and signing and getting people involved in campaigning, we're working to lobby those government officials together with local nonprofits. So sometimes we're working at the United Nations level and political delegations, and at other times we're working with local civil society to make campaigns to raise awareness and educate those delegates through our campaigning. But there's always, we think, something we can do. We really believe that everybody can make a difference, and if we come together, we can make a collective change. So that's kind of our hope for influencing delegates and having them join us on our side, the peaceful side. Sure. Does anybody have any other questions about the voyage or guest speakers or the boat in itself?
Can you show us the eco ship?
Yes, I would love to show you the eco ship. Let's see if we can get should we have Wi-Fi? If you just look up Eco Ship, you can see our new boat. Isn't that exciting? This is going to be the peace boat of the future. Right? Yeah, sailing for change in 2020. Have you ever seen the bullet trains in Japan? Maybe in the movies, or if you've ever been to Japan, they have that aerodynamic front of the ship. Well, we thought for the shape of our ship, we're kind of going by biomimicry, looking at nature's technology. And so we're going in the shape of a whale. Let's see if this video will stay here for you guys. This is a very short video. We are super excited about this EcoShip project because not only will it be the first eco-friendly cruise ship to sail the world, but we're hoping that it will also set the standard and be the leader for other cruise industries like the Royal Caribbean or Disney Cruises or all these other companies that travel around, you know, the Caribbean or the Mediterranean on these voyages to actually make their ships more eco-friendly as well. We know that we have to protect our oceans. In fact, the United Nations just launched a new conference coming up. It's going to be the Ocean Conference, taking place in June. If you're interested in the oceans and want to join it with us, we'll be participating in the conference. But the ocean makes up, you know, 70% of our Earth, and the marine life and our ecosystem is part of that. So we really need to think about how to protect that resource. And by using the ship as a literally a flagship for the Sustainable Development Goals, that will be kind of our future of the peace boat, not just as a ship bringing people and ideas around the world, but also showcasing green technology and providing a space for innovative thinkers and social entrepreneurs to come on board and bring the next level of technology that will change our environment for the better. So that's exciting. 2020. And if you know anybody who wants to help fund this EcoShip, let us know. As a nonprofit, we're always looking for partners, whether they be corporations or United Nations partners or even private donors. But we're looking to build a ship. It's quite expensive, and it's a big undertaking for a nonprofit. So if you have friends and family who are interested, let us know. Any other questions also about the EcoShip or Peace Boat at all? Yeah? Okay.
Thanks so much,
Emily. Yeah, thank you, Natalie, for your presentation.
Questions for Emily about interning at the Peace Boat, getting on the Peace Boat, definitely see her. If it comes to you later, you can always see me about it. We're very excited. Peace Boat has been a longtime friend, and we're really excited to get students on board.
Yes, please. I'll leave my business cards up here at the front, too, so feel free to come pick one up if you want.